Good afternoon. Multiple people have been killed in a car rampage in the US. A warning, some of this footage is distressing. A red SUV ploughing through a Christmas parade in Wisconsin. Dancers and members of a marching band were run down in the attack, putting at least 11 adults and 12 children in hospital. Chaos erupted in downtown Waukesha as the vehicle slammed into the crowd. A police officer fired his gun to try and stop the suspect. A man is now in custody and the vehicle has been retrieved.
We do not believe there's any shots that were fired from the vehicle. We believe that the officers discharged a firearm to stop the vehicle. Because the vehicle went through the barricade.
My heart goes out to all those affected by this senseless act. My heart goes out to those injured as well as to their families. My heart goes out to those who were witness to these events.
Police have confirmed there is no longer a threat to the public, but are yet to confirm how many people have died. A major police task force being labelled Australia's FBI has been announced today, vowing to crack down on drugs and organised crime. Called Operation Phobotaur, the task force will use the intel of 170 officers across 33 countries. And it's already made its first bust, arresting a man after finding 1,000 litres of pseudoephedrine inside a storage facility in Western Sydney.
Operation Phobotaur is aptly named. Phobotaur was the Greek god of nightmares, and the Australian Federal Police and the New South Wales Police will be doing everything that they can to make sure that they are a nightmare to serious and organised criminals. So this operation is absolutely targeted on bikies, on triads, on cartels, and quite frankly, hitting them where it's going to hurt them, which is going to be taking their assets.
The AFP also revealed it's investigating threats from right-wing groups targeting members of parliament. Australia has flung open the border to skilled workers and international students as the Prime Minister faces a tough test in the final sitting weeks of parliament. Let's go live to federal politics reporter Jonathan Kersley in Canberra. Jono, how many people are being allowed back in?
200,000 migrants and international students, Lizzie, are set to be welcomed back into Australia from December the 1st as the country edges towards the final phase of the reopening. The Prime Minister, Scott Morrison, described it as an important step forward, but at the same time, he showed politically he's being pulled from side to side over various issues and is trying to find a way through the middle to speak to voters. Labor's accused him of dog-whistling and pandering to extremists after he condemned protesters who carried effigies and gallows in Melbourne, then said he understood the frustrations of protesters. The Prime Minister's struggle was on show in the Senate during a fiery debate on mandatory vaccinations as One Nation's Pauline Hanson tried to get a bill banning vaccine mandates passed. That failed, but the Prime Minister was exposed. One of his own, Liberal Senator Jared Rennick, says he is withholding his vote for the government, and five coalition senators crossed the floor to support the One Nation bill.
This is about the people's rights and their freedoms, and I will fight them to the death for that reason.
It is the only weapon we have, and we need to do everything we possibly can to keep ourselves safe, our kids safe, our grandchildren safe.
For those of you who say I should not be holding the parliament to ransom, I say this. Politicians should not be holding people to ransom.
There are those who are going to drag me over here, and there are those who want to drag me over there. I know where Australians are. They're not out in those extremes, the vast majority of them.
Labor's trying to cut through the middle too as it pursues the Prime Minister over trust issues, using the final sitting fortnight over the year to target the Prime Minister's changing language on issues from vaccine mandates to electric vehicles, even vaccine delivery.
The Prime Minister did not order enough vaccines when it counted. Why did the Prime Minister say we were at the front of the queue when it wasn't true?
The Labor Party, they want to dwell, Mr Speaker, and look in the rear vision mirror. What we want to do, Mr Speaker, like most Australians who are looking forward to Christmas, looking forward to next year, looking forward to opening their business, looking forward to welcoming tourists back.
It's clear, Lizzie, the Prime Minister is also looking ahead to a polling day in the first half of next year, but it will be an incredibly tight race because if he loses anything, he then loses government.
Jono Kersley there for us in Canberra. Well, hundreds of COVID patients are reporting persistent symptoms months after catching the virus, with researchers trying to better understand its long-term effects. For more on this, I'm joined by Professor Carol Hodgson, the Head of Clinical Trials at Monash University's School of Public Health. Carol, good afternoon to you. Take us through your research, which involved 200 ICU patients.
Good afternoon, Lizzie. Thanks for having me. Yes, we enrolled 212 critically ill patients with COVID-19 from 30 hospitals around Australia last year. It was a great collaborative effort from the clinicians. You can imagine during the pandemic, they were incredibly busy. And we found that the patients at 6 months, the survivors, and I should start by saying 27% of the COVID-19 critically ill population last year died. And of the survivors at 6 months, nearly 40% of them had ongoing disability. And the disability was things like a loss of physical function, so they may have been unable to stand for long periods or walk a kilometre, cognitive function, they had brain fog, they had poor memory, they were unable to multitask, making it very difficult to return to work. And a lot of them had psychological problems, so, you know, how much they were emotionally affected by being sick with COVID-19. And 70% of them at 6 months reported ongoing symptoms. And a lot of these patients had three or more symptoms, the most common being fatigue, weakness, and pain.
Mm. And it's not just people who end up in the ICU who can end up with this long COVID, is it?
No, not at all. That's exactly right. So we know that our critically ill cohorts, for example, swine flu or other influenzas, can have very long and persistent symptoms. And we've been measuring this for a long time. So one of the main questions we've got is, you know, whether there are significant differences between the long-term effects of COVID-19 and other forms of acute respiratory failure that cause persistent critical illness.
And what are some other common misconceptions about COVID that we are beginning to understand now?
Not everybody is getting long COVID symptoms. So I think, you know, while I say that nearly 40%, that means that over 60% of patients recovered by 6 months, and they were very sick. 50% of them were on mechanical ventilation. So it is going to be interesting to see moving forward what that looks like. So, for example, we have no idea whether it's going to be the same this year with the cohort who have Delta.
And what are the treatment options for people suffering long COVID? Are there any treatment options?
There's lots of the hospitals have set up follow-up clinics, which is fantastic. So that means that, you know, the patients are being reassessed soon after discharge home, and they're being linked to services as required. And that might be, psychological services, or it might be physiotherapy if they have ongoing physical function, might be OT if they need assessment in the home for home aides. It might be speech therapy or dietitian if they've got, you know, affected swallowing or perhaps if, you know, their dietary requirements are not being met. And I think that we're going to be very, very busy in the next 6 months following up the cohort that we've had this year.
Well, thanks so much for your hard work. It is really some great research. Professor, thank you so much for your time this afternoon.
Pleasure, Lizzie. Thank you for having me.